I'm glad that you are worshiping with us, wherever you are and whenever you are. Please join me in the call to worship. In the midst of creation, in the fields, in the city, to all who will listen, I will tell of God's love. In the company of the poor, in the presence of the mighty, to all who listen, I will tell of God's love. God's love is more than words. God's love is real and active to all who will listen. I will tell of God's love. Let us pray. Oh God, your steadfast love endures forever, but our love for you and your kingdom is so often temporary and weak. Forgive us when we are apathetic, distracted, or filled with fear. Remind us that love casts out fear. Remind us of your steadfast, enduring love. Renew our minds and transform our will to match your own. Amen.
In worship, we recite the two great commandments to recommit ourselves to following Jesus. Please join me in saying the two great commandments. Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. This is the greatest commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Lord God, you have declared that your kingdom is among us. Open our eyes to see it, our hearts to hold it, and our hands to serve it. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Rejoice in the Lord, O you righteous. Praise befits the upright.
Praise the Lord with the lyre. Make melody to him with the harp of 10 strings.
Sing to God a new song. Play skillfully on the strings with loud shouts.
For the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness.
The Almighty One loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the steadfast love of the Lord.
Our soul waits for the Lord. God is our help and shield.
Our heart is glad in the Lord because we trust in the holy name.
Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you.
If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing.
Love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things.
Love never ends, but as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end.
When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known.
And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, and the greatest of these is love.
For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning, Dylan and Ella.
Hi.
So the Bible passage today is all about love. So when you think about love, Ella, what does it mean to you?
That, like, you care about someone. If you love them, you care about them.
Yeah. And Dylan, what do you think about when you think about love?
I think about, like, showing affection for something.
Showing affection for something. Okay. Do you want to read what it says in the Bible verse? Sure. Read the underlined part.
Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud.
So that's pretty neat, right? It says, this is the Bible telling you exactly what love is. Now, I have to say, over the last week or so, I can think of lots of times when I was not patient, and probably times when I was not kind, and maybe when I envied something, or even when I boasted about something. So I can think about lots of ways when I wasn't really being
loving.
I wasn't being very loving. Let's talk about what do we do in our family sometimes at dinner. What do we do?
Well, we say grace and we say thank you for our food.
Yes, and then what do we sometimes say? What do we say that we've done during the day?
We, like, say, like, what nice things we've done during the day.
Yeah, so we say, like, did you do something kind today? And did you do something that helped somebody else today? So when we're doing that, do you know what we're actually saying?
We're saying we love somebody.
Yeah, we're saying we love somebody, but we're saying this is how we showed love, right? When we talk about all those things, we're talking about how we show love. So for all you kids out there, what I want you to do this week is at dinner time, when you're all eating as a family, talk about the things that you did that were loving and kind and how you might have been patient and all of these things that you think of that are part of what we think of as love. Try to say what you did during the day. And things that you did to try to be loving. So guys, do you want to have a quick prayer?
Sure.
Okay, let's bow our heads. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for showing us what love is.
Thank you for showing us what love is.
And help us to keep showing love to everyone else.
And help us to keep showing love to everyone else.
Amen.
Amen.
There's a song we sing in church sometimes, Lord, I want to be a Christian. It's really a prayer that God will help us to be better Christians. One of the verses is, Lord, I want to be more loving in my heart. That's what we're going to sing today. I hope you'll sing along. Lord, I want to be more loving in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be more loving in my heart, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be more loving in my heart. So, the love chapter. It may be the most well-known passage of Scripture. It's either that or Psalm 23. It's frequently read at weddings as couples look forward to building a life together. And it's frequently read at funerals as families look back on that life together with their loved one. And the text doesn't seem all that churchy, because God isn't mentioned and neither is Jesus. Just love. What it is, and what we are without it. This may be the 10th Sunday in quarantine, but liturgically it's the 6th Sunday in Eastertide. Lectionaries, that is the list of readings assigned to a Sunday, are really an old, old tradition, and there's not just one. There's many, and some lectionaries even date back to the 2nd century. Those who compile the lectionaries do so to enrich our understanding of the church year. For example, in Advent, we hear from the Hebrew prophets about the coming of the Messiah. And we hear about John the Baptist, who, quoting one of those Hebrew prophets, prepares for the arrival of Jesus. After Easter, the time between Easter and Pentecost, lectionaries provide readings that reflect on what resurrection means, and they ponder this new life, the church, that took up the work of Jesus when it seemed all was lost. Today, the lectionary offers us Paul's essay on love to deepen our understanding of what it means to live post-Easter as a follower of Jesus. Maybe part of the problem with hearing this text is that we've heard this text a lot. We expect to hear it gathered with families in all of their wedding finery, the wedding march still ringing in our ears. We expect to hear it gathered with families in black, weeping for those they've lost. At best, they point us towards an idealized version or vision of what we should be but are not. At worst, they're like one of those lovely cross-point, cross-stitch works of art that's intricate and beautiful, framed, put on the wall, and forgotten about. Paul was not writing a pop song. What the world needs now. Although I think he'd agree with the sentiment. He wasn't composing a workbook for premarital counseling. Paul was writing to a troubled church. Last week, we heard how the church had broken into factions. Now, the church at Corinth had gifts. They experienced ecstatic speech. They had talented orators. They were evangelists. They had tons of faith, and they argued about whose gift was more important, whose gift was the greatest. And Paul says, the greatest is love. First, Paul reminds us of what we know, that all these things or abilities or gifts will end. Preaching, passion, even knowledge, all these gifts are fleeting. Paul points us to those things that endure, faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these, Paul says, is love. Wait, how can love be more important, greater than faith? Isn't faith in Christ the most important thing, the key to everything? And if love is the most important thing we can pursue, as Paul states in this chapter, why does the passage imply that we're still missing something? While it so poignantly conveys that love is what life is all about, it concludes saying that we see dimly. We only know in part. What are we missing? It seems, I think there's something deep within us that knows love is the most important thing. And it is also true that caught up in the mundane demands of our life, we can overlook, take for granted, and even sacrifice being loved and being loving. In the opening scene of the movie Love Actually, Hugh Grant's character says that whenever he's depressed, he imagines the arrivals section at Heathrow Airport. There, love seems clear and uncomplicated as people receive and embrace the ones they love. As he reflects on this, he adds, "When the planes hit the Twin Towers, as far as I know, none of the phone calls from the people on board were messages of hate or revenge. They were all messages of love." We know how important love is. We know that love gives meaning to life. And we all live with the hope that our lives will be filled with love. I enjoyed Nate Cady and Dylan and Ella reflecting on love in the children's time and how all of us struggle with living in loving ways, being patient, not being rude, not being irritable. It's hard to read Paul's chapter on what love is because, well, I don't measure up. I get impatient a lot. Don't even get me started on resentment. And my daughter will certainly tell you that I can be irritable. Who? Me? And it's not that I rejoice in wrongdoing, but don't you love it when they get caught? When wily politicians or corrupt corporations receive their comeuppance? What is it that Alice Roosevelt used to say? If you can't say anything good about someone, sit right here by me. That quote always makes me laugh, because we do. We relish the snide remark and the bit of salacious gossip. Magazines, movies, and the news, they all capitalize on our appetite for scandal. Social media feasts on it. How do we truly integrate love in our everyday life? And what does this have to do with following Jesus? Can't we just be good, do good works, and that's enough? Have faith? I believe in Jesus. When Jesus was asked what the greatest commandment was, how to live the best life, Jesus put it in the context of love. Love God, love your neighbor. Mother Teresa once said that if you want to change the world, go home and love your family. There's a story from the Hebrew scriptures about a foreign general afflicted with leprosy. He ends up asking a Hebrew prophet for help. Now, he's an important person, but the prophet doesn't even come out and talk directly to him. The prophet just sends his assistant out to him to give him the message to go take a dip in the Jordan River. "There are nicer rivers back home," the general grumbles. He expected to be asked to do something big, something important, something significant. Instead, he's pointed to splashing around in a shallow, muddy river. We're attracted to grand gestures, to big projects. Loving my family? It seems small. And really, you can take it from me, some of them are not all that lovable. But it's a kingdom thing. Loving those around us is like that mustard seed. It's a small thing, but yields abundance. Loving those around us prepares us to love our neighbor. Loving those around us is a kingdom thing. It's mysterious. Like small seeds planted in the ground, something is happening out of sight. Love is an Easter thing. Like the old hymn says, now the green blade riseth from the buried grain, wheat that in the dark earth many days has lain. Love lives again, that with the dead has been. Love has come again, like the wheat springeth green. When our hearts are wintry, grieving or in pain, Jesus' touch can call us back to life again. Fields of our hearts that dead and bare have been, love has come again like wheat that springeth green. The 20th century theologian Emil Brunner, in his book entitled Faith, Hope, and Love, says that faith is nothing in itself but the openness of our heart to God's love. Faith is the instrument that opens us to God's love. It puts us in touch with the source of love itself. Faith allows us to draw from that source so that the love of God shown in Christ can also be shown in our lives. Our loving choices, then, is a participation in the divine being. For our scriptures tell us that God is love. It helps me to realize that love is not all up to me. In this section of Corinthians, Paul is writing about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. This love is not about my feelings or abilities, but about the very power of God. In these days of angry memes, painful division, uncertainty, anxiety, and fear, it is really easy to ignore the imperative to love. Most days, I feel more anger than love. But then I read about someone like Dennis Runke, a retired farmer from Kansas, who mailed an N95 mask back in March to the governor of New York, writing, "If you could, would you please give this mask to a nurse or doctor in your state?" Cuomo praised the selfless act, noting that Runke's wife has diabetes and only one lung. "How beautiful is that," Cuomo said of their sacrifice. It's that love, that courage, that generosity of spirit that makes this country so beautiful. And closer to home, I know of those sewing masks to help one another and folks in need. I know of those shopping and running errands, others who are assisting folks wanting to connect via technology. Each act of love may seem small, but they are also mighty. That is the mystery we see dimly, how God takes our small acts of love and multiplies them into the kingdom. May Paul's words remain with us this day, this week, and God's love flow through us as we remain open to faith and hope and love. Let us pray. Oh God, you are the source of love, and may our faith open us to the mystery of your love, and may the love shown through Christ show in us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Friends, let us open our hearts to God in prayer. Gracious God, we take so much for granted. We want things to go a certain way, our way. Forgive us our narrow-mindedness. Help us see beyond our small spot on the planet, beyond our place in this moment of time. As we make choices, help us to ask, does this nourish? Is this your will? Is this loving? Transform our understanding, make us instruments of your peace. In this time of sheltering in place, we understand even more the sacredness of gathering, our need to gather, to share the joy of birth, to be close and give comfort when laying someone to rest. We mourn this day the attack on the maternity ward at the Doctors Without Borders Hospital in Kabul, where 2 newborns and 11 others were killed. We grieve for the 24 people killed and the 68 injured during an explosion at a funeral in the Jalalabad province. We pray for the injured, the terrorized evacuees and witnesses, and the frontline personnel and families. We lay our hearts before you in a moment of silence. Lord, have mercy. Lord, in your mercy, protect the hospitals, the public health workers, and the humanitarian organizations that work with so little and do so much, especially during this pandemic. Amplify their efforts, cause our leaders to awaken to right and swift action at the incredible loss of healthcare workers around the world to the virus. Lord, in your compassion, strengthen us to do good and to speak out at injustice. Help us to hear your call in the cries of all your people. Help us to listen for your call in those who hardly speak and those who suffer silently. Comfort the many who are isolated at home, quarantined in ICUs. Comfort the families who do not get to even say goodbye, I love you, one last time. Sustain in your mercy those who are depressed and soothe those who are anxious. Loving God, you embrace all who have regrets and have deep remorse. You have room for everyone. What a comfort that is. Help us likewise to show mercy and tender kindness as we sort out loss upon loss around the world. Help us when we feel anger at the easing of U.S. environmental laws that allow industrial pollution, which steals the air and water, snuffs out life, and kills and kills and destroys habitat. Help us to shine a light on this grievous imbalance of power. Lay bare the acts of greed and corruption. Shed your light on the false values of expediency for the sake of profit. We again offer a moment of silence. Lord, have mercy. Give us purpose and clarity. Help us to gain a sense of urgency for the stewardship of our planet, your creation. Lord, we also offer gratitude for so many caring people and organizations, like the Washington Potato Growers, which gave away over 1 million pounds of potatoes this week. Help us to understand generosity as a powerful, beautiful, loving act, an act that acknowledges the other, the few, the food insecure, the hungry, and those choosing between rent and groceries. As countries around the world take the risk of reopening businesses and other non-essential operations after COVID-19 shutdowns and stay-at-home orders, support the small business owners and the workers who are at risk and the still unemployed. Give us patience, compassion, and unity of purpose. Lord, help us in these turbulent times to to understand the stability of our faith, hope, and love. Faith with action, hope in the knowledge of your enduring love, and love itself that conquers sin and death. Amen.
Please join me as we pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Join me in the closing responses. When our way is joyful, God's love rejoices with us. When the going is rough, God's love supports and strengthens us. We are God's people, held in love. Our hope is in the steadfast love of God. Friends, we travel this way for such a short while, such a little while. So make haste to be kind and be swift to love and care for one another as we walk through these days. Amen.